If you would turn with me in your Bibles to 2 Peter chapter 3, our sermon text this evening comes from verses 10 through 16. If you're following along in your pew Bibles, you can find that on page 1019. Second Peter chapter 3, beginning at verse 10. Hear now the reading of God's holy, inspired, and inerrant word. But the day of the Lord will come like a thief, and then the heavens will pass away with a roar, and the heavenly bodies will be burned up and dissolved, and the earth and the works that are done on it will be exposed. Since all these things are thus to be dissolved, what sort of people ought you to be in lives of holiness and godliness, waiting for and hastening the coming of the day of God, because of which the heavens will be set on fire and dissolved, and the heavenly bodies will melt as they burn? But according to his promise, we are waiting for new heavens and a new earth in which righteousness dwells. Therefore, beloved, since you are waiting for these, be diligent to be found by him without spot or blemish and at peace. And count the patience of our Lord as salvation, just as our beloved brother Paul also wrote to you, according to the wisdom given him, as he does in all his letters when he speaks in them of these matters. There are some things in them that are hard to understand, which the ignorant and unstable twist to their own destruction, as they do the other scriptures. The grass withers, the flower fades, but the word of our Lord will stand forever. How will the world end? What will the final chapter of history be like? In our secular world today, we essentially have two answers to that question, two visions that dominate the discussion about where the world is headed, the telos of the world. Many people today believe that things will just keep getting better and better, that through science and technology, we can and we will achieve utopia. They believe that we can and we will completely eradicate all disease, all poverty, all injustice, and that we will live happily ever after. Now, there are many problems with this view, but perhaps chiefly problematic is that it denies total depravity. It denies that we as human beings are born in sin. It denies that, as the Bible says, that our hearts are deceitful above all else and desperately sick. And if we understand this biblical truth, we know that things will not progressively get better and better, because every human heart is plagued by a death sickness called sin. Things fall apart because human nature, apart from Christ, is enslaved to evil desires and can do no other. And by the way, even a cursory glance at a history textbook will tell you as much. Now, the second view goes something like this. Overpopulation is leading to overconsumption of the planet's resources, and so it's just a matter of time until planet Earth can no longer sustain life, and so we will just inevitably die out. And this doomsday alarmist view has all kinds of problems that we don't have time to deal with this evening. But for our purposes, what I want you to see is that these two dominating views of the trajectory of the world, these visions are incompatible with the Bible. They are incompatible with how the Bible presents the end of history. They are incompatible with our text this evening, because what we see in our text is that God is in charge of the end of history. God has already foreordained the end of history. History is simply his story. It's simply that. It's embedded in the word history, his story. And God is in charge of how his story ends. And our text this evening says that his story ends with final judgment. There will be a day of reckoning. The day of the Lord will be like no other. Look with me at our text, verse 10. But the day of the Lord will come like a thief, and the heavens will pass away with a roar, and the heavenly bodies will be burned up and dissolved. On that day, the Lord of hosts, the Lord of armies, our resurrected and exalted Christ will make ready his war horse, and he will ride out to battle. He will crush his enemies underfoot. He will terrify the wicked with his wrath. This is the vision that we have of Christ's return in Revelation chapter 19. And this day, Christ's return, the day of judgment, it will come as a thief comes in the night. It will come at a time and an hour when no one expects. And the Apostle Peter says that on that day, the works that are done on earth will be exposed. Verse 10. The great reality check for the wicked on the day of the Lord will be this. When the wicked thought that no one was watching, the Lord was watching. When the wicked thought that they could simply coast through life unexposed, in reality, our text says they will be exposed before the fiery presence of God Almighty. And they will answer to the living God for every evil deed. T.S. Eliot got it backwards. The way the world ends is actually with a bang, not with a whimper. And so the question that I want you to wrestle with, that I want us to wrestle with this evening in light of this sobering reality of judgment, the question I want us to wrestle with is simply this: are you ready for the way the world ends? Are you ready for the great and terrible day of the Lord? Are you ready to meet your Maker, the one who knit you together in your mother's womb? Are you ready for the end of his story? If you have entrusted your life to Christ, if you've placed your faith in him, if you know that you are not your own but belong to him, you have every reason to look forward to that day, to look forward to it with confidence and have no fear whatsoever. The good news of this resurrection Sunday is that you will follow Christ in his resurrection, who is the first fruits from the dead. But if you're here this evening and you haven't given your life to Christ, if you haven't yet placed your faith in him, the message of this resurrection Sunday is for you both an offer and a warning. It is an offer from Christ that he will be your righteousness, that he will cleanse you from your sins, that he will give you everlasting life if you believe in him. But if you refuse him, if you harden your heart against his claim on your life, he will refuse you. And on the day of the Lord, there will be no mercy. There will be only wrath. There will be no comfort. There will be only misery. There will be no joy, only terror. Are you ready for that day? The Apostle Peter wants us to know that the entirety of the Christian life is preparation for that day. Verse 11, since all these things are thus to be dissolved, what sort of people ought you to be in lives of holiness and godliness? Peter is saying, how are we to live our lives with the end in sight? If we truly know how history ends, if the Bible tells us how the world will come to a conclusion, if we know things are not going to get better and better until utopia, if we know the world doesn't end with extinction, but with a day of judgment, how does this inform how you and I live in the here and now? Well, Peter answers this in verse 11. Our lives as the people of God in preparation for that day must be marked by holiness and godliness. It's how you prepare for the day of the Lord. And this has been a major theme throughout the entirety of this book. In chapter 1, we read that his divine power has granted to us all things that pertain to life and godliness. And chapter 1 again, as partakers of the divine nature, we are called to be diligent to confirm our calling and election by growing in Christ's likeness. I'm paraphrasing the virtue list there. You could summarize it by saying it's a call to grow in conformity to Christ. We are called to be holy and godly as we prepare for that day, to be holy and godly, even in the face of a world that mocks the idea of coming judgment. We are called to be holy and godly, even in the face of a world that lives for the fleeting pleasures of the flesh that lead to death. We are called to be holy and godly, even in the face of a world that celebrates satanic agendas, that calls good evil and evil good. As sons and as daughters of the living God, those who have been adopted, who share an inheritance with Christ in the family of God, we are a chosen race. We are his royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for his own possession. We are called to be holy as God himself is holy. And we must live in light of this identity, in light of who we are in Christ. If you have been justified with Christ, you will be sanctified. Sanctification is not optional in the Christian life. It's not just something you can add on to the Christian life. No, if you have been raised with Christ and seated with him at the right hand of God, you will and must grow in holiness and godliness. You will and you must grow in conformity to the image of Jesus Christ. And it's not something that we can do in our own efforts. It's something that the Holy Spirit can do in us and through us. It's not always immediate. It's not always linear. There may be ups and downs in your Christian life in the process of sanctification. But sanctification, growing in holiness, growing in godliness as we await that day, is a renovating work. It's a renovating work of God where he is transforming you. It is the work of God's free grace, says the Westminster Shorter Catechism, the work of God's free grace whereby we are renewed in the whole man after the image of God. And we are enabled more and more to die unto sin and to live unto righteousness. Brothers and sisters, God desires your holiness more than your happiness. Do you rejoice in the work of sanctification in your life? Or is the world too much with you? Are you holding on too much to the things of this world. Brothers and sisters, long for your sanctification. Pray for your sanctification. God longs for your sanctification. Pray that he would renew your affections. When I was a young boy growing up in Canada, I played in a Christian hockey league. That tells you how much we love ice hockey. It's so popular that we can have our own Christian leagues. But there were sadly many times where you wouldn't have been able to distinguish between our Christian league and the non-Christian leagues. And I myself was part of the problem at times. I didn't always bear the name of Christ well on the ice. And what the Apostle Peter is calling us to in this text, and really the whole epistle, is that he's calling us to walk the talk. If we claim the name of Christ, if we claim that we are Christians, if we claim that we are those who have died to sin and been made alive to God, we must live like it. We must be the aroma of Christ Jesus to those who are living a fragrance of life, to those who are perishing a fragrance of death. Jesus says this in Matthew chapter 5, verse 13. You, speaking of the people of God, you are the salt of the earth. But if salt has lost its taste, how shall its saltiness be restored? It is no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trampled under people's feet. You see, Jesus here in Matthew 5 is saying, we must be distinct from the world, set apart. We must be the salt of the earth. Jesus is saying to us, if we conform to the world instead of conforming to the image of Jesus Christ, on the day of judgment, there will only be weeping and gnashing of teeth. If we lose our saltiness, if we lose our distinctness, if we lose our shining light and we simply blend in with the darkness of this present evil age, Jesus is saying, we will face eternal destruction. We will be trampled underfoot. The church, the people of God, must be a light to the world, not a mirror of it. What sort of people ought we to be? People who live in holiness and godliness. People who earnestly seek for, people who earnestly pray for, people who earnestly long for our own sanctification. And the Apostle Peter continues, and in verse 12, makes, at first glance, what seems like a strange connection in verse 12 between our conduct as those who are set apart and the coming of the day of the Lord. Picking up from verse 11, what sort of people ought you to be in lives of holiness and godliness? Now verse 12, waiting for and hastening the coming of the day of God, because of which the heavens will be set on fire and dissolved. Waiting for and hastening the coming of the day of God. What does Peter mean here? Of course, we understand the waiting part, right? We wait expectantly for the second advent of Jesus Christ. We understand that, but hastening, hasten the day. In what sense can we or do we play any part in the hastening of the day of the Lord, the day when the resurrected and ascended Christ returns to judge the living and the dead? Right? We're good Reformed people. We affirm God's sovereignty wholeheartedly. Isn't God completely sovereign over the timing of his return in Christ? How do we make sense of this imperative to hasten that day? Well, Dr. Martin Lloyd-Jones is a helpful guide for us here. He connects verse 11 to verse 12, noting that our conduct, our lives of holiness and godliness as we await the day of the Lord, our lives are connected to the hastening of the day. In some mysterious way, God providentially uses human action to lead to divine action. God uses our action on earth to accomplish his will of one day ushering in the new heavens and the new earth. And as Lloyd-Jones says, knowing this biblical truth, knowing that the Lord uses our actions, our decisions here on earth for his glory and to accomplish his will, his ultimate will, Lloyd-Jones says this should make us even more courageous, even more bold to share the gospel, to share the resurrection hope that we have in Christ. This reality should make us all the more earnest to be a people committed to prayer, to pray big things, to pray that the Lord would transform our cities, that the Lord would transform our countries, that the Lord would transform us. And so I urge you this evening, commit yourself to living holy lives, to being a people of prayer, to being a people who share the good news that we have in Christ, so that through your set-apartness, men and women might come to a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. And brothers and sisters, what exactly is it that we hope for? What exactly is it that we, the people of God, are waiting for and hastening? Verse 13, look with me in your Bibles. But according to his promise, we are waiting for new heavens and a new earth in which righteousness dwells. Friends, this is what Easter is all about. This is what every Lord's Day is about. This is what Resurrection Sunday is about. The resurrection of Jesus Christ, his triumph over the grave, means that all who believe in him shall not perish, but will have everlasting life. Everlasting life in the new heavens and the new earth in which righteousness dwells. And the new heavens and the new earth will be nothing like the way heaven is conceived of by Mark Twain in Huckleberry Finn, The Adventures of Huckleberry Finn. No, heaven is not a place where we float around in the clouds playing harps for eternity. No, heaven is creation regained. It is Eden restored to the fullness in its perfection. And in the new heavens and the new earth, we will experience the fullness of communion with the triune God. We will see him face to face. We will walk with him as we were created to do so in the beginning. We're not going to be floating ghosts, immaterial spirits hovering around in the clouds. No, we will be embodied beings like Jesus Christ who can taste, see, experience, touch, feel. And we cannot even begin to fathom the joy that we will experience in being in God's presence, in beholding him. What no eye has seen, nor ear heard, nor the heart of man imagined, what God has prepared for those who love him. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 9. And in this place that God has prepared for we who love him, in the new heavens and the new earth, righteousness dwells. Righteousness dwells, verse 13. What comfort there is in these words. In a world of unrighteousness, in a world that is groaning, in a world where children are murdered in the womb, in a world where human beings are exploited for the pleasure of other human beings. In a world where power and greed have led to wars and mass casualties, in a world where our bodies face decay, illness, sickness, anxiety, and on and on and on. How wonderful it is to think that God has prepared for us a place where every wrong will be made right, where no unrighteousness can even possibly dwell, only righteousness. Things will only be as they ought to be in the new heavens and the new earth, the place where righteousness dwells. And there, God will dwell with us. He will dwell with us, his people. He will make his dwelling place among us. And as Revelation chapter 21, verse 4 says, there, in his dwelling place with his people, he will wipe away every tear from their eyes. And death, that's what we're celebrating this Resurrection Sunday, death shall be no more. Neither shall there be mourning, nor crying, nor pain anymore, for the former things have passed away. And as we long and look forward to the day of eternally dwelling with God, we are called in the here and now to redeem the time. Be diligent, Peter says in verse 14. Be diligent to be found by him without spot or blemish and at peace. Are you being diligent in your Christian life? Have you wasted time that you need to repent of? Confess it to the Lord. And remember that the gospel means that, as Joel chapter 2 says, the Lord will redeem the years that the locusts have eaten. The Lord will restore the time. When Christ returns, how will you be found by him? Will you be found, verse 14, without spot or blemish and at peace? Will you point to Jesus Christ, who is your paschal lamb, who covers all of your iniquities? Will you be able to point to him and say, his righteousness, his purity, his blood for my life, because you've placed your trust in him? Are you ready to be found by the Lord? Count the patience of the Lord as salvation. Verse 15. The Apostle Paul, who agrees with Peter here clearly, verse 16, and who also happens to be hard to read, I'm glad I'm not the only one that thinks that, he also reminds us to redeem the time in Holy Scripture. And we'll see this in a moment in Romans chapter 6. But as we saw last week in verse 9, God is patient with us because he wants us to repent. And now we see that God is also patient with us because he wants us to be sanctified. We must not take advantage of the Lord's patience in the Christian life. God's patience towards us and our sin must never be taken as a license to sin. The Apostle Paul in Romans chapter 6 reminds us that we who are in Christ cannot go living in sin so that grace may abound. We cannot take advantage of the Lord's patience towards us. We who have died to sin must not continue to live in sin. As we come to a close this evening, I want to return to the first question I posed. Are you ready for the day of the Lord? Are you ready to meet your Maker? Are you ready to meet Jesus of Nazareth, the one who died in your place and was raised triumphantly and conquered death so that you and I might have life in him? Are you ready? Have you tried the world's definition of life, of what living means according to the world? Have you tried it and found it wanting, found it empty, found it fleeting? Then come to Jesus. Come to the one who has conquered death, who is raised victorious. Come to Jesus because he offers you life. And his resurrection, this Resurrection Sunday, guarantees that on the last day, you and I will rise again. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet sound, we will put off the perishable, and we will put on what is imperishable, and we will dwell in the radiant light of his presence, and in beholding him, we will be transformed from one degree of glory to the next. Amen. Let's pray. Lord God and Heavenly Father, we pray that you would make us ready to meet you. May our lives be nothing more than a preparation to meet our God and Father in the peace and righteousness of Jesus Christ. Make us ready, O Lord, by the power of your Spirit. Conform us to the image of Jesus Christ. May we die to sin more and more. May we live to Christ more and more. Lord, may the things of this world grow strangely dim as we await the second coming of your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. And it is in his name that we pray these things. Amen.